us safe and well. Dance to songs and poems, cause no one here will tell. We're doing our own parts while watching church on screen. Take time to call and tell each other love is what we mean. Oh, stay at home, stay at home, stay at home all day. Taking time to read our Bibles before each other pray. Hey!
Good morning. Welcome to worship on this May 31st. Wherever you are in the world right now, just know that you are currently at First Lutheran Community Church. We are gathered together wherever we are in the world through the mystery of the body of Christ, and we're going to celebrate that promise today by gathering together in digital means. We're going to have communion together. We're going to pray together. We're going to sing together. We're going to hear some new and different words today. Because this is Pentecost, so hopefully you have your red on. Hopefully you are able to see some of the different red people wearing their red clothes to celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit that we posted either on social media or different places. So hopefully you are able to connect in that way. But today is the day we make good on all the promises of the church. For on Pentecost, we celebrate the birthday of the church, for the Holy Spirit came into all of us through those disciples that were trapped in that house, that were locked away in that house, and we get to see that connection but realize all that we've gained from it today. And so we are going to have a special guest speaker a little bit through the service. I'm still going to give a sermon, but I'll leave it to Phil to tell you a little bit more about why I asked him to speak a little bit later. But we are gathered together because it matters. We gather together because we're stronger together. With that said, this has been a hard week. If you've been paying attention to what's been going on in the news, the things that have happened in Minneapolis, I don't always like to script what I'm going to say, but I wrote down something for right now. It's going to lead us into a moment of silence, but I want you to hear these words on something that's been affecting me and pretty much everybody in this country this week. As I watch the unjust, unconscionable death of a young African-American man on a street corner, and after watching a video of someone calling the police on someone for trying to pet their dog, after this has been a god-awful week for loving our neighbor as ourselves, I feel all the right words absolutely failing me. But we cannot let racism win. We cannot let hate win. We cannot let our neighbors stand alone. Don't let your love be just words. Don't let your view of a better world live on only in your head. We're going to have to strive daily for it. That much is clear. As the words fail me, as the words fail many of us, we know that God can hear our prayers nonetheless. Let's take a moment of silence now to pray without words, to lift up Minneapolis, to beg God to help us build a better world. Let's have that silence now. Amen. Building on that silence, but building on that hope that there are ways for us to move forward, let us begin our worship service with our confession and forgiveness. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we might release our worries and our concerns and genuinely enter this space. Let us breathe out our troubles and breathe in you. Take a moment now to breathe. Allow us, O God, to grow into fullness, receive your forgiveness, and hear your word for us on this day. Amen. A brief note about the song we're about to sing. It's a song called O Day Full of Grace, and it was put together by the Association of Lutheran Church Musicians as part of their virtual hymn project. And so you're going to see this incorporated 1,300 singers and instrumentals in order to make this one song. And so as I thought about our Pentecost promise about us being united in one as the Holy Spirit, and we think about our Lutheran heritage, this is kind of the perfect song for that. For those of you that like more contemporary music, it might not be exactly your cup of tea, but see the whole thing and watch as the image slowly zooms out to show you all the people, all those crazy Lutherans out there that sang together, that made this joyful noise together in order to remind us of whose we are, how connected we all are, and the God that is watching over all of us. So let us sing now.
Thank you.
this day, you open the hearts of your faithful people by sending into us your Holy Spirit. Direct us by the light of that Spirit, that we might always advocate for your justice and rejoice at all times in your peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always, and also with you. I invite you to share that peace now with your neighbor in one way or another, via a call, a text, a wave out the window, any way that you can connect to somebody safely. I invite you to do that now. Now we come to our traditional offering time, which you can use in the traditional sense if you like by going to firstlutheranpo.com and scrolling down to online giving and giving through there by mailing a check to a church, doing it how you would normally do it, although in a removed fashion. But this is also a time for you to offer yourself, to offer all that you have and all that you are to God. So this is kind of a two-part time of offering what we've been given and then offering that connection to God either by lighting a candle or spending some time in prayer now. So I invite you to use this offering time how you will. Make the most of it. Let us sing. Let us pray. Merciful God, our ordinary gifts seem small for such a celebration, but you make of them an abundance, just as you do with our lives. Feed us again at this table for service in your name, in the strength of the risen Christ. Amen. All right, this is children's time, so if you are a child and you'd like to come forward, do so now. We're going to once again do fireside chats with Beckett and Asher, and we're going to be talking today about a story that kind of hits really close to home. It's a story about the disciples. They think Jesus has passed away. They think Jesus is not living anymore because they saw him get crucified, or at least heard the stories. And so they have locked themselves in their house away from everybody else. They are a little scared, a little nervous. They don't know what to do. And so they're kind of sheltering in place.
And so this is that story where it's kind of closer to who we are. Different reasons for being in your home, but we can connect to it. And so they're in this house by themselves, Beckett and Asher, and all of a sudden, inside the house, what do you think happens?
God.
Jesus shows up. That's right. Jesus shows up, and he says, "Peace be with you." He actually says it three times. Peace be with you. Can you guys say that?
Peace be with you.
Good job. So what does peace mean, do you think?
I come in peace.
I come in peace. So what would that mean?
It's good.
Yeah, it is a good thing. It means you're not going to harm anybody. You're not going to hurt anybody. You're going to be peaceful. We talk about it. And so Jesus comes to the disciples when they're kind of scared and alone, and he says, "Peace be with you." So he tells them, you know, calm down. Things are going to be okay. You're not going to get hurt in those ways. And spiritually, he allows them to be at peace. And then he finishes, after he says this, he gives them the Holy Spirit. And we talked a couple weeks ago about the Holy Spirit. He says, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." And so he gives us, he gave the disciples, but through them, he gives it to us, the power to forgive. And so what does it mean to forgive?
I forgive you.
And when do you say, "I forgive you"?
Am I sorry that I did something wrong?
When somebody does something wrong and then you forgive them for doing it. And so a lot of times when you guys get into trouble, you have to go in your room for a little bit. And then you come out of your room and you go to the person that you've hit or yelled at or done something naughty. And what do you say?
Sorry.
Sorry. You say, "I'm sorry." And then the person says what back to you?
It's okay,
which is our way of saying, "I forgive you." But sometimes when you come out, the other person is still really upset, right? And they don't always say it's okay. And do you know what happens when that happens?
They don't talk to you,
that's
they
right.
Don't
and
play with you.
They don't play with you, and you guys get really upset because you kind of feel trapped. Like you want to say sorry, but they're not hearing it. And so what Jesus has given us is the power to forgive people and to be forgiven. And it's a big deal. It's part of how we get that peace, where we know things are going to be okay because we don't have to hold on to that and be angry or avoid people or worry about it because we can forgive and we can have peace. Does that make sense? So it's a pretty big deal. While they're in their house, locked away, Jesus comes in and appears to them, and he gives them the power to forgive and the power to have peace. And we need that now, right? Because sometimes we go a little crazy and we need some peace, and sometimes we go a little crazy and we need the power to forgive, right? All right, let's pray. Let us pray, let us pray, let us pray.
Dear God,
we thank you for giving us
your peace.
Help us to forgive others and to be forgiven. And all God's children said,
Amen.
Amen. Good job, guys. Thank you for coming
on.
Cry, God's people in fear, what they hear, afraid to die. God's voice of flame, Holy Spirit by name, their voices strange, their voices change, they exchange words of God Most High. And the people said, "Swoosh, Holy Spirit, fill my heart, come and do your part, start the fire in my soul. Swoosh, here's what we've got to do, that's the flame. Peter speaks, he's a Jesus freak. He tells the crowd, "Don't be loud, I'll tell you what this means." Then Prophet Joel, he played his role, his message clear, it did appear. The unc see visions, the old have dreams, even the lowly servants, it seems. Miracles in the sky above, wonders on the earth below. Sun goes dark, the moon turns red. Finally, disciple Peter, he said, call to the Lord, Gentile or Jew, and the Lord shall save you. For still I feel my heart. They're all part of the heavenly host. But on this earth, we have the vision. Share the swoosh with the Jesus vision. Breaking down barriers of evil and hate. We'll all join hands at the pearly gates. Join hands now with each other. Share the swoosh with your sister and brother. Take the flame of his holy love. Shout out loud to the Lord above. Swoosh. Still I feel my heart. Come and do your part. Start the fire in my soul.
Our first reading comes from Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. And yes, we are having two readings today, in part because it wouldn't feel like Pentecost if we didn't have this reading from Acts, but also because it's going to help us to get into what our guest speaker, Phil, is going to be talking about. So let's hear these words from Acts. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divine tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of them in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jew and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea, all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist, the sun that shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. And now we're going to hear from Phil Waite, one of our more recent members. I asked him to speak, particularly because of his background, in part the tradition that he comes from, but also he's a very learned individual. So I would invite you to hear his words and think about how what he is saying might enliven your experience of this Pentecost and your own experience of the Holy Spirit moving in our midst. And so Phil will speak, and then we'll have the gospel reading, and then we'll have a sermon. So I invite you to hear Phil now.
Hi. Speaking in tongues is a phenomenon and experience in which people speak words that are apparently in languages unknown to the speaker, although not necessarily always unknown to the hearers present. Glossolalia is practiced in Pentecostal and Charismatic Christianity as well as other religions. It's a Greek term, glossolalia. Pastor Adrian asked me to speak briefly about it because my wife and I spent about 35 years of our adult lives in a church that practiced speaking in tongues and, in fact, required it for membership as evidence of being baptized in the Holy Spirit. We left that church and that stream of Christianity about 10 years ago, not because of speaking in tongues, but for a host of other reasons related both to other aspects of doctrine and practice. Theologically, speaking in tongues has its roots in Pentecost, when the post-ascension disciples of Jesus were gathered in the upper room and the Holy Spirit descended on them, and it resulted in speaking in tongues. The New Testament book of Acts, as well as several of the Apostle Paul's letters, contain many references to speaking in tongues as evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, as a spiritual gift, as well as references in detailing how to handle the situation where speaking in tongues occurs in a public meeting. Perhaps the most telling of these passages cluster in 1 Corinthians 14, where Paul says some really interesting and key things. In verse 4, those who speak in tongues build up themselves, that is to say, they edify themselves. Verse 5, I would like all of you to speak in tongues. Verse 18, I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. In verse 27, in a public setting such as a church service, if anyone speaks in a tongue, let there be only two, or at most three, and let each speak in turn, and let one interpret. As it was practiced in that stream of Christianity as we knew it, it was known or observed in primarily three ways. The first was as a personal prayer language that was practiced in private devotional prayer. Second, it was practiced as a form of, again, of personal prayer, but personal prayer in a group setting, such as a church service or a Bible study. And in that case, there might have been several people present, but when you prayed in tongues, you weren't talking to them, you were talking to God. And then the third setting, it was used in the sense of an ecstatic utterance or maybe a prophetic utterance in a public church service by the person who is either preaching or by someone from the congregation. In every case when I witnessed something like that, there was always an interpretation, or the leadership on the platform would pause and they would wait for an interpretation, and if no interpretation came, they would suggest that this was not from God, and then they would move on in the service, which is obviously kind of embarrassing to the person who was moved to speak in tongues out loud. So my wife and I no longer belong to that kind of church and have stepped far away from many of their doctrines and practices used there. And we now affiliate with the Lutheran stream. But that being said, Deb and I still at times will use the gift during personal prayer and or when we simply don't know how to pray, which is a situation described in Romans 8:28. Is the experience of speaking in tongues something where you lose control of yourself or your senses and enter into some sort of ecstatic trance and some other entity uses your mouth and vocal cords and you can't control it? No, it doesn't work that way. your voice and your tongue is always under your own control. It's like when you're in the middle of a fight with your spouse and you're intensely arguing, your voices are very loud and you're yelling, and the phone rings and you pick it up and very sweetly say, "Hello." It was always under your control, and it still is. We always have a choice and we always have control, and speaking in tongues is no different than the expression of any of the gifts of the Spirit outlined in 1 Corinthians 12. They're always under the control of the user. I can share a couple of instances where things happened while praying in tongues. First, one time while driving across Southeast Idaho, I was praying in tongues and I suddenly felt my tongue change. Like suddenly I was speaking in a completely different prayer language than my normal prayer language. And then a few miles down the road, it suddenly reverted back to the original prayer language. And I had no idea why until on my return trip, I realized that the exact place where my tongue had changed was when I entered into a Native American reservation, and when it and I reverted to my normal tongue when I crossed back out of the reservation. My wife had a phrase in her prayer language that she often repeated, but she had no idea where it came from or what it meant, only that it was a fairly common refrain in her prayer tongue. Years later, like more than a decade later, we discovered that the phrase that she was repeating was actually a Latin phrase often used in the Lutheran liturgy, and it was Kyrie eleison, which in Latin is Christ, have mercy. Her youth was unchurched. She'd never heard the term anywhere. We had never been to a church with a liturgy, and there was no way she'd been exposed to the term, but it was in her prayer language and was repeated frequently in her prayer language, and we know it now as Christ have mercy. Thanks.
Our gospel for today comes from John chapter 20, verses 19 through 23. Hear the good news for this day. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O God, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Grace and peace to you from God, our creator and our savior and friend, Jesus Christ. Amen. My mind went a lot of places for what I wanted to say to you all on this Pentecost Sunday, as you are in your home and I am in mine. This is the Sunday we celebrate the birthday of the church, at a time when the disciples were locked away, fearful, uncertain of the future, and then God broke into their midst. Normally, at First Lutheran, we like to get into the happy birthday side of things, breaking out the candles, our brightest red shirts, cutting out red flames to be handed around. But right now, we find ourselves perhaps more connecting with those pre-Holy Spirit disciples, those locked away disciples, rather than the Spirit-filled prophets who appear drunk to those who don't know better. But after asking Phil to share his story and a bit of the history around speaking in tongues, and after watching the great things that he shared, it made everything crystallize in my mind of what I wanted to share with you today. I asked Phil to speak with you about speaking in tongues, not because I want us to become a quote-unquote a speaking in tongues congregation, although the mental picture of a bunch of reserved Lutherans trying to do that is absolutely delightful. And I asked him not because I want you to start policing who is doing Christianity right and who is doing it wrong. In fact, that's the opposite of what I want. I asked Phil to share because I want us to be reminded of all the gifts of God that are out there in so many different ways that we can connect to in one way or another. Now, I don't personally speak in tongues as it is classically understood. After all, I was raised a reserved Lutheran. But my prayer life, my prayer language, has always featured more of a back and forth than I ever usually admit. When I go someplace to be alone, when I quiet my mind and allow myself to breathe, when I start offering my joys and my worries and my questions to God, so many times I hear in my mind a response coming back. Often in words I would not use, and usually offering advice I don't want to hear. Many times I'll sit down without the right words to say or even knowing what to pray, like right now in the midst of all that's going on in our country and in our world. And I'll just sit. And I'll offer all of this. All that I'm going through. Silently. And so many times I feel, I hear, I see God respond. I have always more or less considered this a Lutheran version of speaking in tongues, although I do know more than a few Lutherans that speak in tongues in that traditional sense. Again, I bring this up not because I plan to do worship differently in this regard once we all get back together, but because of passages like the one from Acts that we read for today that says, "In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams." And our gospel for today has this. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." When we think about the gifts we have been given by God as Christians, many times we'll point to hope. We've been given hope, which is true. Or we'll point to eternal life. Which is absolutely important. But far too often we leave off the list all the things we've been given now, the physical, tangible gifts, all the ways that God breaks into our shelter-in-place world and reminds us that God is alive and active now, bringing us peace, if we allow it, bringing us visions for the future, if we allow it, bringing us forgiveness, if we allow it, bringing us so many spiritual gifts that we only need to reach for, trust in, and live out. Does this mean I expect all of you out there to be praying in tongues in this traditional sense? No. But on this birthday of the church, as we hear this promise once again that we have been gifted the Holy Spirit, isn't it high time we start making the most of this gift? To find ourselves set free from fear like those disciples were, as we stride out into the world that will face unprecedented challenges and will desperately need people of vision, shouldn't we become those people that Acts predicted we would become? "I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams." I got chills as I heard Phil talk about driving across that Native American reservation as his prayer language changed, as it reminded me, as we all need to be reminded, we live in a spiritual world, not just a physical one. There is more waiting for us out there to connect to, and that is what this birthday Pentecost celebration is all about. It's not about defining who is right and who is wrong, or who is in and who is out, but about realizing that there is more out there waiting for us. For God has broken into our small world, our comfortable world, our at times fearful worlds, and brought to us that one thing we never realized we were missing until we saw all that could be gained. The very Spirit of God. Whether it's learning to meditate, learning to talk to God, learning to listen, learning to be prophetic, learning to fight for justice, learning to help others heal in one way or another, learning new ways to see and experience God, let this birthday of the church, let this Pentecost, let this coming of the Holy Spirit change something about your life, your faith today. Don't let this coming week be the same. Don't let this coming month be like the last one. Let your life be enriched by the Holy Spirit, and then go out and enrich the world. Amen. with all Christians throughout time, let us confess our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Uplifted by the promised hope of healing and resurrection, we join the people of God in all times and places in praying for the world, the church, and all who are in any need. Creator God, we call on your Spirit of righteousness. Wherever we as a people are divided, unite us. Wherever we are prideful, humble us. Wherever racist ideals have taken root, heal us. Give each one of us a heart for justice and empathy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We call on your Spirit of unity, O God, giving thanks for our different vocations. Activate and utilize the diverse gifts present in your church, that they reveal your love for all and help to make a better world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We call on your Spirit of healing, gracious God. Bless nurses, doctors, midwives, chaplains, counselors, and hospice workers as they care for those in need. We pray for all who long for comfort, especially those names we offer you now, either silently or aloud. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. With bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, we place all for whom we pray into your eternal care. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our service continues with communion. We now have our two readied up communion assistants that are happy to help us here for this Pentecost Sunday. Huh?
Red shoes.
Well, you don't have red shoes on.
You do.
I do have red shoes on. They just can't see it. So for this Sunday, we once again are reminded that we are all connected through this Holy Spirit that came into our lives. This is another part of that connection, another part of those gifts that we have been given. And so we are going to unite once again around the communion table. Hopefully you have bread and wine and grape juice there in your home. If you don't want to take communion in this way, hopefully I'll remember right before we give out the bread to do the blessing. And so we're going to bless the elements now. So together, we remember the night in which our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." Remembering Jesus' life, his death, and his promise to come again, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen.
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 All right. So, do you want to rip off a piece? Wait, no, we're going to remember to do the blessing. Receive a blessing if you don't want to receive communion in this way.
Can you look at that?
All right, well, hey, buddy. Hey, babe. We're going to do the blessing first, okay? Okay? Receive the blessing now. May Christ go with you wherever you go, reminding that you are his, that you are claimed, that you are a child of God, and God fills you with the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right.
The body of Christ broken for you.
The body of Christ broken for you.
I've been so small.
It's okay. It doesn't matter how big the bread.
Can I have that one?
Do I give it to you? Give it to me or for me? Okay. Thank you. To them, and then you're going to offer it to me, okay? So blood of Christ shed for you.
Blood of Christ shed for you.
Okay, well, okay. Amen. Hold up, guys. Hold up, hold up. Hey, wait. Blood of Christ. Oh, wait.
Blood of Christ shed for you, and you gave it to me already.
Blood of Christ shed for you. This is a family meal provided for you. As you can see, in families, things do not always go as planned, but still, God is present in our midst, and still we move forward together as one united body of Christ, working to do the needed work that this world is so desperately calling us to do. So be strengthened by this meal and go forth. We continue our service with a prayer. Life-giving God, you have fed us with your word, and our hearts burn within us. Through this meal, you have opened us to your presence. Now send us forth to share the gifts of Easter with all in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now we come to a part of the worship service that I've put off for a long time, because I know it's not actually anyone's favorite time of the worship service: announcement time. And I don't know that I'll necessarily stick with announcement time, but for this week, I wanted to touch on two things. One, you'll notice I'm back in my house after being in the church, and I know that me shooting the video in the church was meaningful for many of you, of getting to see that space and being reconnected, and I'm going to try to regularly go back there and produce these videos from there more often when I can. Sometimes it just doesn't work out with the schedule and trying to make everything work, but I will try to be there more often. Because even though we're now in phase two as Kitsap County, where we can now have gatherings of 50 people, we're not getting rid of these online worship videos, because many people won't feel safe leaving for a while. And this provides that extra opportunity for more worship for those of you that are maybe in a different state even, but just can't leave your houses right now. And so we're going to keep doing this. And so I'll keep trying to video from the church when possible. The other thing I want to note is that, yes, as I said, we are in phase two now in Kitsap County. Yes, we can have gatherings of 50 people. And yes, I do pride myself on being a person that tries to be innovative and do things in new ways, and being willing to try new things. But one of the things that I kind of refuse to be innovative around is your health. So we're going to go slowly forward. You're going to see some announcements about some potentials for getting together going forward, but we're still working on the logistics of that. We're going to go slowly into it. We're not going to be the first that rush to have a 50-person worship service. We're hopefully going to be the first to do it in the best way. As we learn from other people that are working to make churches safe, we're going to go out of our way to make you safe. So pay close attention for when those announcements about re-meeting up will come, but we're going to err on the side of keeping you as safe as we possibly can. So we appreciate your patience, we appreciate your support, and that's the end of this announcement time. So we conclude our service with a blessing from Deacon Marge.
Good morning. I invite you to open your hands and your heart and your very being to receive God's blessing at this time. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Call and tell each other love is what we mean. Oh, stay at home, stay at home.